14, 14, 14, 14. Do I need to be in other words? 14, 14, 14. Thank you very much, that was my opening number. Trust me, I can get much better than this. Yes, I'm Graham, and I'd like to thank all of you lovely, warm-hearted, generous people for coming along to this gig tonight, this free gig. We were going to charge for tickets, but the lawyers stepped in, some legal mumbo-jumbo about the use of the word comedy. So you got tonight for free. Yes, not a penny. The only thing it's cost you is a couple of hours of your time and a little piece of your soul. Bargain. Yes. Yeah, and it's great to see you all here. Great that you all made it on time, Katie. I was delayed getting here. I say delayed, it was just like 2 or 3 minutes. Had to drive around a pile of coal in the middle of the road. It was just a minor inconvenience. I told you, there's no special one. But I'm here, and I made it. And I'm here because I've been on a comedy course. Yeah, but for those of you who don't know, a comedy course, it's a bit like a... How can I explain it? It's a bit like a wedding cake making course, but with more tears. They laughed at me at work when I said I was going to do a stand-up comedy show. They're not laughing now. They're not laughing now, because they're not here. Bastards. But you're here, that's what counts. The course was great. I recommend it to anyone. Week one, we were taught the fundamental rules of comedy. I say rules, there is actually only one rule, one comedy commandment that thou shalt not break. And that is, a comedian never steals another comedian's material. Yeah. I can't speak for the others on the course, but I, for one, am glad that's the only taboo, because I'm sleeping with the compere's wife. The compere, that's Mr. Sam Avery, ladies and gentlemen. Don't go to his head. Anyway, this is my stage. This is my spotlight. Strikes dramatic pose. Some people go on the stage, they don't like the spotlight. I actually can't find it quite comforting, because it means I can't see the audience members crying. Talking of audience members, if Sam's wife is out there, I must apologise for that joke. I didn't mean to embarrass you, by the way. I'm gay, so obviously I'm not sleeping with you. I'm sleeping with Sam. Didn't know it yet. But Sam was great. No, not in bed. Not that he's not great in bed. Let's not say again. So on the comedy course, Sam was great. He instilled lots of his comedy knowledge built up over many years of people laughing at him, sometimes even when he's on stage. He said, you've got to find yourself on stage. Well, nailed that one, yes! He said, there's no such thing as a bad idea. He's obviously never read Piers Morgan, My Story. He said, you've got to base your comedy on your personality. I thought, great. I went home, and I said to my husband, I'm going to base my comedy on my personality. He looked me in the eye, and his most supportive voice said, personality? Well, that's you, Scrooge. You know, they say the secret of great comedy is, ladies and gentlemen,
timing,
yes. The secret of great comedy is timing. You should have been here at 6:30. The dress rehearsal was hilarious. Actually, the dress rehearsal was very good, but you know what was lacking? A live audience. You can't beat a live audience. I mean, Sam, bless him, he tried his best to create the illusion of a live audience. Didn't work. The cardboard people just weren't cut out for it. The balloon people were a bit of a letdown. And those little Russian dolls, they just sat there the whole time and ignored us. I don't know, Russian dolls, they're just so full of themselves. But one of the hardest things about comedy is deciding what to talk about. And I struggled with this. I wrote a whole list and I went through them, crossed them off one by one. For example, I was going to do, I ruled out doing anything at all on philosophy. I mean, what's the point? I was going to do a couple of jokes about hobbits. But was scared that the Lord of the Rings fans would think it was just a Tolkien gesture. I did consider doing a whole set about my husband Richard, except I very quickly realised that with that he'd kill me. That's not a joke, by the way, ladies and gentlemen. He would actually kill me, take the cat and jump on the first plane back to Taiwan, save the knowledge that there's no extradition treaty. So, and I had a brainwave. I thought, I know. I could have a stab at vampires. Until somebody pointed out to me that vampires have been done to death. But, yeah, but they did say that apparently zombies are making a comeback. Yeah. So, yeah, it's just got out of the back. Talking of zombies, people don't know this. You're the first people I've admitted it to, but I am actually the world's first zombie comedian. Yes, if you don't believe me, come on to my next show and you can watch me die on stage over and over again. I'm going to leave you. Yes, this is the end. I'm going to leave you with the words of Mary Smeesh, who wrote in the Chicago Tribune back in 1997. And you may have heard this. She said, do one thing every day that scares you. Yeah? Yeah? I've taken this to heart, ladies and gentlemen. I have it stapled to my bedroom ceiling. So now every morning when I wake up and open my eyes, the first thing I see is a life-size cutout of Nigel Farage. It scares me every single day. Apparently Nigel does the same thing, except he's got a life-size cutout of an immigrant. Who knew? Whatever works for you. Thank you very much indeed, ladies and gentlemen.